Hey guys, number one Marmaduke fan here, and I have too many comics to review. So I've gotten into the bad habit of doing an unboxing video and then forgetting about the comic and saying, "Oh, well, I'll get the review done next week." And then a month passes. Oh no, I have way too many comics. So here we go. It's time. It's time for catching up on comics. We're gonna unbox it and then we're gonna review it all in one go. This is by Larry King Undead. He is kind of like an interesting character. I've done a few live streams with him. He has a very big, over-the-top personality. And also one neat thing about how he does indie comics, I don't think he's done any crowdfunding. So a lot of indie comic artists go to Kickstarter or they go to Indiegogo as a platform to, introduce people to their work and to sell their work. Now, Indiegogo and Kickstarter both take a chunk of the proceeds out of it, right? So you're paying for it that way, but theoretically, what you're getting out of Indiegogo and Kickstarter is they're helping you organize it, and maybe they're helping you promote your work. Like if you're like the number one book on Kickstarter, the number one book on Indiegogo, it's a cool advertising thing. Larry King has basically chosen to skip that, maybe save on the cost of what they take out of it. And basically, his policy is just let me know if you want one of my comics and PayPal me, and I'll send it to you. And that's a pretty neat model. I personally think I'm still going to use the crowdfunders just to give it a shot and give it a try and say I did. But part of me thinks that it would be a good idea to keep offering it for sale. Might as well make every dollar I can even after the crowdfunder ends. Maybe, I don't know, maybe add some like special perks to the Indiegogo or something for people who are real collectors or real nerds about this stuff. But basically, like, leave an option open for future sales. He went with a simple yellow envelope and he kind of folded it over along the side so there wasn't a lot of extra wiggle room in the envelope. That's a pretty smart idea, pretty cost effective. So here we go. I haven't read any of these before. All right, so he's got them in kind of like the standard floppies, and he's got a smaller one. Interesting. So I'm guessing he used one of the classic sleeves and then just folded it over nicely, like a Christmas package. A Magna Comica production, Rutung Adventures. Sweet. It's kind of like a giant robot. And Man Stores the Hive by Larry King. And for mature readers, a Magna Comica production, Flapjack, Grave Concerns. All right. So we're going to read them all and we're going to review them. Three, two, one, go. And we're back with Rutung Adventures, three short stories by Larry King, printed by Kablam Comics. There's a cool little code if you want to 10% off your next order. I like the format. It has kind of like a sturdy little, kind of like construction paper style. No, it's tougher than construction paper. Maybe tough like cardstock with a shiny gloss on the outside, and just kind of like nice quality paper and black and white art on the inside. So let's talk about the character Rutung. I really dig it. It's rated for mature readers for some violence and gore and for some sexy ladies, but it has a really nice moral heart to it. Rutung's the good guy, and one of the things that really struck me about him is he is a good guy. Like, he just feels sympathy for innocent people who get hurt. He doesn't show mercy to bad guys or witches that eat children and innocent people. And he has a really strong internal dialogue. So first story is Rutung is a sellsword, so he goes and looks for jobs, and there's a job to take down a witch. So one kind of neat thing about him is that he looks like a very cartoony character. He's got like the big eyes, he's got the three fingers, but the world he's in and his behavior is pretty serious. He's kind of like a straightforward fantasy hero who has to deal with like not cartoony threats, but real legitimate threats. So and there's kind of like a nice pattern where he gets the job, he finds the bad guy, and he has to think through the problem to take him out. So he uses internal monologue to kind of like think about the problem and what he's going to do to react to it. I think in the second story there was something I wanted to highlight. So he sees a poor guy who's been injured. Okay, this page is important because something I've mentioned before that's not quite obvious is, although it's true that you should try to show, not tell, a lot of the times in telling stories, there are rare occasions where it's better to tell than show. And this is a great example where He saves this guy and he gets all this info from this guy. Now, if you were to show all of this, you would have to probably take 20 pages to show like all of the steps and all of the setup and the monster attacking the innocent people and destroying them, right? So basically all he does is he talks to the guy and he gets his story. And as he's approaching the bad girl, he relates through narration what the guy told him. So basically this is a nice way of just giving us what we need to know about the monster and the innocent people and then getting him to the fight as quickly as possible. So it's a really nice way of, tightening up the pace. Also, I'm personally not the biggest fan of editorial boxes being used for internal narration, but Larry King uses them quite smartly. So one of the problems I have with them is sometimes there can be mix-ups about who is thinking, and this worked perfectly, and he did it without color. So the evil temptress Egyptian snake goddess is hatching her evil plans, and so she has some internal narration. I can smell another trespasser. So how do I know she's the one thinking? Well, because Rutung isn't on the page, and she's clearly the focus of the page. So I know she's thinking. And then it switches back to Rutung, and I know that Rutung is thinking. Why? Because the girl's not on the temptress isn't on the page anymore. It's just Rutung, and he's dominating the panel. So when he says I know it's Rutung talking. Very, very smart. It would have been very easy to have a mix-up there. So Larry King's really good, actually, at just making sure you can follow who's thinking, who's saying what. There's also like a neat pattern where Rutung doesn't seem to be human, and all of the stories seem to underscore this subtly. Like, he's got the glowing eyes, he's got the giant suit of armor, he jokes about how he doesn't have a mouth, and some of the bad guys he fights notice this. We don't know his origin story yet, or why he is this way. It's just kind of like a striking thing about him as he's going on his adventures that he doesn't quite seem to be fully human, and we don't know why. There's also kind of like this neat twist-a-roo. So the last two, you know, witches or pharaoh goddesses he fought were evil, you know, cannibals. So of course, when they tried to tempt him, he said, "Begone, thought." Then the last girl he saves is kind of like a nice girl who's being kidnapped by the Fish King. He does a pretty smart thing where he gets the door to shield him from the Fish King's blast. And then she, the girl comes onto him. So she's not an evil goddess who wants to eat him or anything, but he still denies it. He still says no to the thought, even when they're not a evil cannibal. And we're kind of getting the hint that maybe he can't sleep around with these women. Maybe it has something to do with his condition, or maybe there's something inhuman about him where it just wouldn't work. And he's kind of it's neat that he's very merciful and sympathetic to innocent people and the people he's rescuing, but it's basically like zero mercy and zero sympathy and zero bleeps given to monsters and cannibals and kidnappers. Like, absolutely zero problem, killing and chopping them up and eating them for supper. So just a really straightforward, really fun, very sincere and good character, and that really struck me and really interested me. I want to know more. I want to know his backstory. I want to see him go on more adventures, and a really good example of using internal dialogue well to flesh out the character's inner thoughts and the strategy of what he's going through as he fights. So definitely check out Larry King Undead and see if you can pick up Rutung Adventures. Oh, let's do the next book. Let's go. Part two, looking at Manstewers by Larry King. This issue is called The Hive. So I did take a look at some of his art before deciding to buy them, and I kind of could tell just by looking at it that Larry King makes weird comics. Like, he is just deliberately into making weird comics. Now, the neat thing about Rutung, which I just reviewed, is it's kind of like a general, like, straightforward fantasy character with a weird cartoony element to him. Like, he's kind of a cartoony character, but the world he lives in is a pretty serious fantasy world with, like, monsters that are real threats, not cartoony threats. So Manstewers is a lot weirder. Like, the main character has a waffle for a head. This is even funnier if you kind of know Larry King, because he also has like a very weird, exuberant personality. So it's sort of like I see some of his personality in this. And I'm starting to get a feel that Larry King likes having taking like really weird characters and maybe putting them in heartfelt situations. So Lil Waffle is in love with what's his girlfriend's name, Mella. And so Mella gets in trouble with these monsters. So Lil Waffle has to go man up and go save her. And so again, he's also, Lil Waffle is having some internal monologue. He hears his girlfriend's in danger. He has to like kind of think through the situation and go save her. A couple things about this is, I noticed in this issue, Larry King likes a lot of straight-on angles, and I feel like that could be pushed maybe a little bit more. Like we could do a few more of the like, kind of like exciting bird's eye views, exciting worm's eye views. But I think he really makes his art work by having he has a really good sense of black and white and composition, right? So you see how he uses a solid black a little bit in every panel, so that gives it some warmth. Sometimes his figures are a little bit stiff, but the line work is really clean. He can draw a beautiful, sexy lady. He cares about getting some details and kind of like establishing the feel and texture of the world. So he's got like an underground kind of outsider art style, but you can really tell he cares about making it look cool. And the story and the quick pacing of the stories helps a lot as well. Lil Waffle gets his chainsaw and goes to save his girl. There's some neat stuff of the characters, like, sort of like thinking about the monsters and their limitations and how much danger they're in. I'm gonna show like one page. So, like Lil Waffle tells his girl to look away as he's cutting through the monster. And it's kind of like a repeated panel shot with the blood splattering on him. This is kind of like an example where I feel like you could ump the ante a little bit. Like if you had like one shot and then a closer up shot and then a closer up shot, it kind of like we get this feel of like building tension. I almost never see a repeated panel thing work, like, 'cause it'll always your eye is really good at seeing patterns, so every time you reuse a panel, it jumps out at you really jarringly. But that's really the only example I've seen so far. Generally speaking, he every panel feels fresh and feels like its own thing. And I don't know, I just kind of like the vibe. Like a genuinely heroic little hero. He's kind of a short little guy. He's obviously a freak of nature and has gotten picked on for having a waffle for a head, but he has his beautiful babe girlfriend who is so thankful for him to him for being a hero and manning up and saving the day. So it's kind of like Larry King has this really, really, really weird aesthetic, but the story underneath it is very sweet and wholesome and heroic and affirming. So I liked Rutung better because I feel like the weirdness was balanced with like the really cool fantasy aspect of it. Manster is even weirder than Rutung, but I still enjoyed the heroic aspect of it. So if you like weird comics, I think you'll love Manstores. If just based on the fact that it has a if you don't think you'd like a comic book about a guy with a waffle for a head, well, there you go. You probably wouldn't like Manstores. But if you think you'd like a comic book about a guy with a waffle for a head, you're gonna love Manstores. All right, let's read the next one. All right, last review, Flapjack, Grave Concerns. So, kind of like let's address the elephant in the room. Manstores stars a guy with a waffle for a head, and Flapjack stars a guy with pancakes for a head. So, kind of like by the end of this, what I've gotten for a feel for is that Larry King likes weird ideas. It's like he gets his weird idea and he says, "All right, let's go for it. Why not?" It's kind of like he changes it up, even though there's like a pattern of all three have a weird idea it to them. All three have kind of like their own completely unique vibe. So Rutung is a very sympathetic and kind of guy. Like he doesn't care about killing monsters and cannibals, and he'll even like eat monsters if he beats them. He's like a very genuine kind of guy, a cartoony knight in a scary fantasy world. Manstewers, Little Waffle is kind of a nerdy guy, got picked on as a kid, found love with his hot blue girlfriend, and mans up and saves her. So Flapjack's more of an anti-hero. He's like a cocaine addict. He's making drug deals, and if you're muscling in on his drug territory, he doesn't feel any compunction about like killing you and laying waste to you because you were competing with his turf. So much more of an anti-hero, much more of a villainous type of character than the other two. Also, this is a more mature. All three of them have a mature rating, but this one has some bare boobies. This one has some F bombs. This is definitely like the most mature and dark of the three. And there's also this pattern where like the weird protagonist also has like a beautiful, beautiful lady who's his partner. So his partner's a vampire, and he brings her as like his enforcer to murder other like competitors in the drug market, which means she can like take a lot of shots and take a lot of punishment and eventually heal herself. But if you shoot her in the kneecap, she's going to be out for a while. The drug bust is going well at first until like this weird guy with a finger for a head shows up and puts a gun to Flapjack's head. So again, it's like this pattern of like just weird stuff. This guy's got pancakes for a head. This guy's got a finger for a head. There's like all this intense, kind of like hard-boiled detective inner monologue, and it ends with after they barely get out alive, he has to give his girlfriend some blood to help her restore. So a darker character, a much less heroic character, a drug addict, but also kind of like this neat pattern of just a weird, weird guy and his beautiful girlfriend with monstrous powers in a pretty semi-serious drug bust situation. So definitely the darkest and definitely the most mature rated of the three. So just speaking for myself personally, Rutong is my favorite because the fact that the hero is kind of like so genuine and heroic in this rough and tumble world, it's kind of like you gave it a nice contrast between the good and between the rough. Mansoor's, I got a chuckle out of it because, I don't know, it was kind of like a simpy good guy sort of character manning up to save his girlfriend. With Flapjack, it's a similar gag where there's this weird, really weird, goofy aspect to it contrasted with a serious aspect. With Flapjack, it kind of lost me. It felt like Flapjack was going for like as hard and as R-rated as possible, and it didn't quite have that same, I don't know, like nice, wholesome quality contrast with the weirdness and the darkness of the tone. But I still kind of appreciate the commitment to a weird idea for Flapjack. So just speaking purely for myself, I'd say Flapjack gets third place, Mansoor's gets second place, and Rutong gets first place. So I love weird comics. Like, I am all about weird comics. That's part of my favorite thing about indie comics is just finding weird and strange stuff. Flapjack's definitely the darkest of the three, but I will be following Larry King, and I will try to buy more Larry King comics in the future, especially Rutong. So Larry King, if you watch this, I definitely feel like you have an aspect to your work where you have an idea, you say I'll go for it, and you make it happen. I really respect that. Then one thing to think about is which of these ideas do you like carry on with and tell more stories about? So if you had to like pick any of these three characters to do a series about or to do more adventures about, I would definitely say I feel like there's something golden about Rutong. There was just something that really worked about him for me. So if you just want my advice, the one of these to like turn into a series or turn into like a long manga epic adventure, I really want to see more of Rutong, find out his backstories and see his further adventures. I think you're tapping into something with that. But I still enjoyed Mansoor's and Flapjack, two just really authentic, really weird books. So that's it. We did it. I'm number one Marmaduke fan. I love you guys. I will link to Larry King's Twitter in the description of this video. So go check him out. Catch you later.